Harper Audio presents It's Not Like It's a Secret by Misa Sugiura, performed by Emily Wu Zeller. Chapter 1
Sana, chotto.
話があるんやけど
Uh-oh. Something big is about to go down. It's Sunday afternoon and we're almost ready to leave the beach at Lake Michigan, where I've begged Mom to take me for my birthday. It's just the two of us because Dad is away on business. He's always away on business. And I'm crouched at the edge of the water, collecting sea glass. I've decided I'm not leaving the beach until I've found 16 pieces, one for each year. Sweet 16 and never been kissed. But at least I'll have a handful of magic in my pocket. 16 surprises. 16 secret treasures I've found in the sand. And now this.
話があるん。
Mom never asks if I want to chat, unless she's actually gearing up for a serious discussion. She walks over and stands next to me. But I'm too anxious to look up. So I continue picking through the sand as possible serious discussion topics scroll through my head. She's pregnant. She has cancer. She's making me go to Japan for the summer.
It's about Dad, she says.
Dad's leaving us. He's dying. He...
Dad got a new job with startup company in California.
What?
It's the company called GoBot X, she says. They make the robots for hospital surgery.
I don't care what the company makes. Did you say California? When I say serious discussion, I suppose I should really say big announcement followed by brief and unhelpful Q&A before Mom closes topic. How long have you known?
Dad applied last month. He signed the contract today.
Why didn't you tell me earlier?
No need.
What do you mean, no need?
She shrugs. No need. Not your decision.
But that's not fair.
Fair doesn't matter.
But...
Complaining doesn't do any good.
Are we all moving? When?
Dad will go in 2 weeks, at end of May. He will find a house to live. And we will go at end of June.
She doesn't know the answers to the rest of my questions. Where will we live? Where will I go to school? What am I supposed to do all summer all by myself?
Then she says, No more questions. It is decided. So nothing we can do. Clean the sand off your feet before we get in the car.
We don't talk on the way home. Mom's not the type to apologize or ask questions like, How does that make you feel?
My own unanswered questions swim in circles around the silence like giant schools of fish, chased by the most important question of all. The only one I can't ask. When we get home, I go to my room to finish some homework. But before I start, I take out a lacquer box that Mom and Dad bought for me when we visited Japan 7 years ago. It's a deep, rich orange red, and it has three cherry blossoms painted on it in real gold. Inside, I keep my pearl earrings, a picture of me with my best friend, Trish Campbell, when we were six, all the sea glass I've collected from trips to Lake Michigan, and a slip of paper with a phone number on it. I pour in my new sea glass, take out the piece of paper, and stare at the numbers. They start with a San Francisco area code. Could this be the real reason we're moving? The paper is small and narrow, almost like something I might pull out of a fortune cookie. Like if I turn it over, I'll find my fortune, my family's fortune, on the other side. Yes, these numbers are important.
No, these numbers are meaningless. But of course, the back of the paper is as blank as ever. I bury the phone number under the other things, put the box away, and lie down on my bed to think. A few minutes later, Mom comes in and frowns when she sees me lying on my bed, staring at the ceiling. Mom is the most practical person I know. She doesn't sugarcoat things, and she doesn't look for a bright side. Which is okay right now, because a fake spiel about exciting new experiences, great weather, and new friends would just piss me off.
I am sorry that you have to leave your friends, she says,
not looking one bit sorry.
But the pouting doesn't make your life better. It just prevents you from doing your homeworks.
Then again, it probably wouldn't kill her to show a little sympathy. Also, she's totally off base about what's upsetting me. But since correcting her is out of the question, I just turn and face the wall.
自分のことばかり考えんのやめなさい。 ちゃんと返事しなさい。
I don't think I'm being selfish. But since...
I'm not being selfish!
Is probably not the proper reply she's looking for. I just say,
I'm not pouting. I'm thinking.
There is nothing to think about. If you want to think, you can think of being grateful for a father who works so hard to get the good job.
It's not that I'm not grateful.
Ever since he was a teenager, she continues. Dad dreamed of working for the Silicon Valley startup. That's why he came to United States.
But what about me? Don't my dreams count?
Okay, maybe now I'm being a little selfish.
Especially since the truth is that I don't actually have what might be called dreams. What I have are more like hopes. Straight A's. A love life. A crowd of real friends to hang out with. But it's also true that if I did have dreams, they wouldn't count anyway. Not to Mom.
You are too young for the dream, she says.
See? I want to remind her that she just said Dad's startup job was a teenage dream. But she has a conveniently short memory about things she's just said that contradict other things she's just said. So instead, I switch tracks. What about your dreams?
My dream is not important.
Ugh, come on, Mom!
She crosses her arms.
My dream is to make the good family. I can do that in Wisconsin or California.
Mom, why do you say stuff like that? Like, oh, our lives are just going to change forever. No big deal. It is a big deal. It's a huge deal.
I can hear myself getting screechy,
but I can't help it. Dad changes our lives around without consulting anyone. Well, without consulting me. And Mom just lets it happen. It would make anyone screechy.
Shikkari shinasai, she snaps.
But I don't know if I'll ever be able to do that. Gather myself into a tight little bundle with everything in its place.
Shikkari.
Like she wants. I put my head under my pillow. She's quiet for so long that I begin to wonder if she's left the room. When I peek out from under the pillow, she's waiting for me. Her face softer, even a little sad.
Gaman shinasai,
she says, and walks away.
Gaman.
Endure. Bear it without complaining. Her life's motto and my life's bane.
Chapter 2. I'm under orders to pack all of my belongings into boxes labeled keep and throw away by the end of the week. Which is harder than you'd think, because who knew I had so much stuff? I'm drowning in a sea of
books, old papers, and odds and ends that I've spent over a decade smushing into the corners of my closet, cramming into the back of my desk drawers, and piling on the edges of my bookshelf. It started off easily enough. My lacquer box, keep. 4 Super Balls from who knows where or when, throw away. Collection of poems by Emily Dickinson, my favorite poet, keep. Assorted elementary school certificates, perfect attendance, 4th grade math Olympiad participant, etc., throw away. But now it's getting tricky, because some of the things I've dug out have some messy feelings attached to them, and I'd rather not go there right now. Don't think, just sort. The wedding picture that I found in the attic last year and that Mom refuses to display because it's showing off. Keep. The Hogwarts robe that I loved so much I wore it 2 Halloweens in a row. I'd meant to be Hermione, but everyone said I was... who else? Cho Chang. Throw away. A cheap plastic vase left over from my 13th birthday party, which 3 girls skipped to go to the movies instead. Throw away. Don't think. As I toss the vase into the throwaway box, a scrap of fabric flutters out. A swim team ribbon that I found in the Glen Lake Country Club parking lot when I was 7. Now that's a feeling I can do something about. All the best families in Glen Lake belong to the Glen Lake Country Club, which has a historic red brick clubhouse, a lush green golf course, and a lily white membership. Back in grade school, when Trish and I spent more time together, she used to bring me with her to the club all the time during summer vacation for barbecues and lazy afternoons at the pool. But in high school, she became suddenly, dazzlingly popular. The boys and queen bees started swarming. Her Instagram filled up with likes and pictures of people who barely acknowledged me in the halls. And our country club days became a thing of the past. Don't get me wrong. It's not like she's been mean or anything. Days might go by without her texting me, but she always answers my texts right away. She's usually too busy to hang out with me, but she's always apologetic. And even though it's painful to sit on the edges of her crowd at lunch, listening to stories about parties I haven't been invited to, it's not like anyone's ever asked me to leave the table. When we used to see more of each other, Trish was always after me to open up and spill everything. Which, whatever, she's an oversharer. For example, she texted me seconds after Toby Benton, her first boyfriend, put his hand up her shirt in 8th grade.
OMG, I just let Toby touch my boob under my shirt.
But whenever I thought about telling her anything important, I froze. Even now, when people talk at lunch about who wants to hook up with who, or who hopes their dad gets custody on the weekends because he's totally cool about drinking at the house, I feel relieved that no one's especially interested in me or my life. I don't want anyone poking around and freaking out about what's wrong with my family. What's wrong with me? Like, what if I'd answered honestly the first time Trish asked me at the beginning of freshman year, Sana, who do you like? Well, actually, Trish, I think I might have a crush on you.
Nope. Forget it.
Not happening. I'm not even 100% sure it's true. And life is already complicated enough. But now, things have changed. I mean, we leave in 3 weeks, and I might never see her again. So I'm going to ask her to bring me to the first Glen Lake Country Club barbecue of the summer. For old time's sake. I've got nothing to lose, right? We'll get drunk together for the first and probably last time. I've never been drunk before. And maybe, if all goes well, she'll get nostalgic. We'll bond again, and
And something good will happen. I don't want to think too hard about it.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.